Well, good evening and welcome. I'm Gleaves Whitney. I direct the Hauenstein Center for Presidential Studies here at Grand Valley State University. And I want to welcome you to our fourth summit. It's our fourth annual summit. It got all kicked off in 2013 with a grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities. And we've had a great conversation going since then, a lot of good, vigorous debate, and that's the way it should be. Now, making this ambitious program this evening and over the next day and a half possible are several elements that I want to point out. First, 19 scholars who've come in from coast to coast to be with us and share with us their scholarship and their insights. Two partners, the Progressive Women's Alliance and the Russell Kirk Center for Cultural Renewal, represented by Noreen Myers and Annette Kirk. Would you all please identify yourselves so we can applaud you for your support for this? Thank you very much. And we've had one generous donor also in K.P. Wolters and the Kate and Richard Wolters Foundation that made this particular conference possible. Now, I wish I could say something about the fantastic weather that we could take credit for here, but we had several people down in Florida recently, and they're taking credit, but our Canadian here with us tonight, he's the one taking credit for the nice weather, so we'll let them duke it out. But between now and Sunday morning, this weather is going to hold, but I think it's going to be somewhat stormier in here, and that's good. We're going to be doing something extraordinary. First of all, we're going to have, I think, a sustained conversation without mentioning the name Donald Trump very often. Now, we're going to explore a very important community of discourse, or the other way of looking at it, maybe it has not been a community of discourse, as we look at two great threads of thought in the United States. We have, as in any open pluralistic modern society, you develop a party of innovation and a party of conservation and their own traditions. And at the Hauenstein Center, we're interested in where the party of innovation and the party of conservation come together. I've never understood the attitude that the middle is boring, because where these two traditions come together is anything but boring. It's because they're clashing, they're debating, it's the intellectual discovery and repudiation, the rise and fall, or as one of my old professors who is here in the audience, David Hollinger, says, who wins the debates? And that is an ebb and flow that we've seen over the decades between these two parties. So what we're going to do is a lot of fun over the next day and a half. I'm so glad you're here. Just so you all are aware, C-SPAN is going to be covering the proceedings tomorrow. So behave and ask lots of good questions while we have all of this talent with us. I would now like to bring forward Joe Hogan, who is our program manager for the Common Ground Initiative at the Hauenstein Center. Please welcome Joe.
Thanks, Gleaves. As Gleaves just mentioned, this evening's keynote address commences the Hauenstein Center's fourth Common Ground Summit. One of the central purposes of this year's summit is to explore the ways in which the humanities can inform and inspire politics. After all, it's the humanities, the study of history, literature, and philosophy that allow us to become more empathic, more imaginative, more capable of identifying the fundamental humanity we share, even with our fiercest political opponents, those with whom we most disagree. There are few people on this continent, probably the planet, as experienced in navigating the space between politics and the humanities than this evening's speaker, Michael Ignatieff. Dr. Ignatieff has effectively led two intersecting careers in politics and the humanities, each remarkable in its own right. On the politics side, Dr. Ignatieff was deputy leader and then leader of the Liberal Party in Canada from 2007 to 2011, after having been elected to Canada's parliament in 2006. Before that, Ignatieff worked for years as a television broadcaster and editorial columnist at The Observer in the UK, and then as a professor in the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard. Presently, he is a member of the Queen's Privy Council for Canada. On the humanities side, Dr. Ignatieff has held teaching posts at the University of British Columbia, Cambridge University, the London School of Economics, and indeed Harvard. In 1998, he wrote what is the authoritative biography of the political and social theorist Isaiah Berlin. He's written numerous other books, fiction and nonfiction, including Scar Tissue, The Rights Revolution, Human Rights as Politics and Idolatry, and Fire and Ashes, Success and Failure in Politics. Presently, Dr. Ignatieff is Edward R. Murrow Professor at the Harvard Kennedy School of Government. He serves as Centennial Chair of the Project on Global Ethics at the Carnegie Council on Ethics and International Affairs in New York. We are both pleased and privileged to have such a distinguished speaker this evening. Please join me in welcoming Michael Ignatieff.
Thank you. Good evening. It's a great pleasure to be here. I brought you good weather, and I'm delighted to share it. I started this morning in Boston, and you'll be delighted to know it's about 20 degrees colder. So you got some of the best weather on the continent, and as Gleaves said, it's going to get stormy inside here tomorrow, but it will be also convivial. I can't tell you the criteria that I have for accepting invitations of this kind is if I think the question that I'm being asked is really interesting and important. And I really do want to publicly celebrate the Hauenstein Center and Gleaves Whitney in particular for this initiative. The search for common ground is just incredibly important. It's incredibly difficult. It's too important to leave to the politicians. Very little should be left to politicians, in my view. It should be left to us as citizens. I'm not a citizen of your country, but I love your country, and this country has been very good to me. And I'm delighted to take part in this effort to try and bridge a gap of polarization and antagonism that has a lot of American citizens of both sides of the political aisle worried, rightly worried about the future of this wonderful republic. So I'm happy to be part of that. And I do bridge the gap between the professoriate and the killing floor of politics. I've done both. As you may have heard, my political career as the leader of the Liberal Party of Canada was nasty, brutish, and short. I faced a national electorate 3 times in 6 years, won 2 national elections, but I lost the 3rd. And losing is not the nicest way to learn what politics is all about, but as Scott Fitzgerald memorably said, there is a certain authority in failure. And I want to use that authority to talk to you tonight about the humanities and politics and what a professor learned about bridging the partisan divide. First, I'd like to say just a word or two about Canada, because some of you may be seeking asylum there in November, and I thought you'd want to know what it's like. views about Canada in the United States mirror the polarization that we're trying to overcome at this conference. For liberal Americans, Canada is a kinder, gentler America, while for conservatives, Canada is a failed experiment in the nanny state. One of my favorite descriptions of Canada is by Pat Buchanan, the well-known conservative pundit. He called Canada Soviet Canuckistan, which I thought was truly hilarious. I love that. Many of you know, because you're close to Canada and some of you may vacation there, that Canada fits neither of those stereotypes. It's a small C conservative country with strong progressive traditions. It has a political culture that blends British civility with some American black arts. It's a country that believes in big government and then sometimes has the wisdom to stymie big national initiatives. It's a stable country, famously stable, that has
25-30% of the country wants to break it up. And it is a country whose divisions have bred an innate caution in our political system, but whose enduring unity is a source of pride to those of us who are its citizens. And I like these contradictions because they rebut the most enduring cliche that you probably have about Canada, because whatever else is true about my country, it ain't boring. Now, I have a large stake in the question that we're talking about tonight, which is bridging the partisan divide. And if you just allow me to talk a little bit about my political experience, then we'll get into the American context directly. I feel one of the reasons I lost the 2011 election, there are many reasons, including my own incompetence, but one important reason is that I underestimated the amount of partisanship back home in Canada. I wanted to create a big red tent in the center of Canadian politics that would be socially progressive and fiscally conservative. But my tent blew away. It was blown away from the left by the New Democratic Party, a social democratic party. It was blown away from the right by the conservatives of Mr. Stephen Harper, who went on to become prime minister. So I know all about the collapsing middle, because it collapsed on me. But the key thing I want to say tonight is that despite my defeat, I'm convinced that the votes that count most for a better politics in your country and mine remain in the center. But partisans are going to have to change our tone and our message if we want to recapture the common ground. Though it pains me to admit it, the conservative politician who beat me, Stephen Harper, did so by grabbing the center ground out from under my feet. He knew that the country, Canada, is a small C conservative place, but our people have no time for sectarians. So he refused, this is, I think, a message for American conservatives, he refused to allow evangelicals, anti-abortion ideologues, or anti-gay rights activists to capture his party's agenda. He essentially conceded that conservatives had lost the culture wars of the 80s and 90s. And then he changed the subject from the culture wars to the economy and earned support towards the center by presenting a fiscally conservative small government agenda that was very reassuring to voters swept up in the 2008 financial crisis. So in doing so, he seized the center and moved it 3 degrees to the right. And last October, my successor, Mr. Trudeau, seized the center and has moved it 3 degrees to the left. But my point is, the center still holds, and it's still there, and it's still where the action is in politics. I think the conservative success in the last decade in Canada has something to teach American conservatives, though I have never seen an occasion in which an American learned anything from Canada. So I'm just saying, do you know what I mean? I'm just talking. I'm doing my best here. I don't expect you to take lessons from up north. You take it for granted, that's fine with me, but I do feel there are things we can tell you. Anyway, one lesson from the conservative success up north is don't let sectarians define conservatism. Don't make Mr. Goldwater's mistake, which is to think that extremism in the defense of liberty is no vice. It is a vice. Sectarianism is a vice, and sectarianism will keep conservatives from achieving power. But there's a message here also on the other side for progressive partisans. Almost the most essential thing I learned in politics is that voters are not partisans. You got to distinguish between partisans and voters. Voters are deeply unlike partisans. To use the distinction made famous by the German sociologist Max Weber, partisans believe in the ethics of ultimate ends, while voters believe in the ethics of responsibility. That is to say, partisans put convictions ahead of results, and voters tend to put results ahead of convictions. So one of the rules of politics that was kind of branded into me is it's extremely important for political leaders to know the difference between a partisan and a voter, to understand the difference between these two audiences. And rule number two follows quickly after that, which is don't make a promise to a partisan that you can't also make simultaneously to a voter. There's a world of difference between winning primaries and winning elections, between lighting up your base and lighting up an electorate. You can win nominations by running towards your base, but if it's power you're after, you better run towards the center, because that's where the votes are. Now, this used to be the conventional wisdom, but it isn't the conventional wisdom now. It has become a cliche that the median voter, that voter, moderate voter in the middle, no longer exists because the electorate has fractured. And it has now become a kind of poetic cliche that the center cannot hold, and that the poet William Butler Yeats was right when he said that the best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity. Yeats was a wonderful poet, but in this I think he was wrong, because I think the center still holds. So how do we get back to a political system where progressives and conservatives both compete for the vital center? It's not going to work if you try and put conservative and progressive agenda items in some kind of political Vegematic press button and mix it all up together. That's not going to work. It's not going to convince voters. Policy, in fact, does not define, I think, where the center exists. And policy wonks, although professors wish this were true, policy wonks do not rule in the real world of electoral appeal. Nor is moderation in language and tone sufficient to get to the center, because a polite and civil sectarian is still a sectarian. What defines the center, I think, is a broad belief that politics is essentially about two things: finding compromises between antagonistic interests, and secondly, keeping the show, by which I mean the republic, on the road. It's a procedural rather than a substantive middle ground. People can disagree vehemently on specific issues of policy, but still occupy the same common belief about what politics actually is. And I learned this from voters. The voters I knew and tried to convince when I was in Canada, and there must be some of them down here, the voters I know like conviction, but they don't like ideology. And you have to understand when you're a politician that you can feed red meat to your party workers and your political base. But if you feed red meat to voters, it turns them off. And it turns them off because they feel you're speaking at them and not to them. And they know the difference, you know the difference, between someone who has convictions and someone who just has an ideology. And the other thing is that voters understand politics very differently from politicians. Having been a politician very briefly, I know that they're lifers. It's their career, it's their life, and when your life is on the line, you'll do anything to stay close to the trough. But voters think differently about politics. It's not their life, and they don't regard politics basically as entertainment. A lot of more interesting ways to entertain yourself than turning into CNN. What voters understand is that politics is the arena where they go every election cycle to select a representative so they can get on, do things that are more important in their own lives. Now, voters understand their representative duties, and they're prepared to cut the representative they choose some slack, but they expect representatives to earn their keep and not play stupid games. And voters, you, have limited patience with political game playing, especially when the game is played with your money. So when evaluating a politician, voters are looking for someone who takes them seriously, who talks to them in a language they understand, someone who knows that real problems are complex, and who also knows that a representative's role, a politician's role, is to craft some halfway decent, better than nothing, reasonable solutions. And this non-ideological, pragmatic, problem-solving realism has been shoved aside in the last couple of decades by politics as spectacle, politics as reality TV, politics as open warfare. But I sense that voters, and I mean you, are beginning to push back. You're tired of politics as reality TV. And the reason you're tired of politics as reality TV, it has a kind of low comic value from time to time, but it's a sorry show because you sense that it's not about you at all. Politics has become a spectacle of personal aggrandizement by the political class, a political class that does not hesitate to cultivate sectarian hatred. And neither of those ideas has any fundamental relation or interest for you as citizens. You want someone who knows that politics is a job that's essentially about you and your interests. And this common sense of politics, this common sense view of politics, I think, remains alive and well in our electorates. I've heard this line spoken to me by people who are never going to vote for me, but understood politics exactly the way I did. And I've heard it from progressives to the left of me who never vote for me, but they understood that this practical, realist conception of politics was what they wanted politics to be. And I'd argue that both sides of the political divide in the United States have departed from this common understanding of what politics is about, and in the process abandoned the common ground on which the future of a sane politics depends. Both progressives and conservatives are turning voters off. Both sides are too shrill. Both sides are too knowing, too certain, and they do a lot of braying at you. Both play games, and each has lessons to learn. Now, I've just done a plague on both your houses, and in the interest of truth in argument, those of you who show up tomorrow night will, I hope, talk to or listen to E.J. Dionne. E.J. Dionne is a wonderful commentator on American life, and he would disagree vehemently with what I just said. He and other theorists of this problem of partisanship would argue that sectarianism is more a problem of the right than of the left, and that Republicans are more to blame for the partisan divide than Democrats. And there may be some truth to this, but I worry about the complacency in this argument, because it's basically a very common idea among progressives that we don't have to change, but they do. And I don't think that's being sufficiently honest about this problem. I think we need, I count myself as a kind of progressive, we need to be honest with ourselves. I mean, some progressives need to learn that it's pretty obvious that a government program isn't necessarily the right solution to every problem. The progressive heritage, and I revere it from Roosevelt right through the Lyndon Johnson, didn't always produce good government. Sometimes it just produced big, expensive, clumsy, and arrogant government. And progressives need to understand that their own tradition delivered some ambiguous results. I think the other thing is that progressives need to listen more carefully to voters, because in their own lives, voters know that for some problems, there just aren't any good solutions. There is such a thing as tragedy in human life. There is such a thing as the irremediable. And so voters' lives have taught them that let's be a little suspicious of solution peddlers, bright-eyed believers, that there's nothing that evidence-based good public policy can't fix. And that is an illusion, by the way, that is very current in the public policy school where I have the honor to teach. Voters, I know, are alive to the fact that the best laid plans of mice and man oft go awry. Progressives, I think, need to think about the fact that they are too enamored of their own good intentions, too little attentive to the frequent fact that good intentions sometimes play out in bad consequence. Equally, on the other side, I think conservatives have some things to learn before they can compete for the middle ground. I think, it's what a progressive would say, I know, but hear me out, that conservatives take their suspicion of government too far. In the Reagan Revolution, Reagan captured, I think, voters' disillusion with liberal good intentions. But the conservative agenda that developed in the 60s and 70s worked better as a critique of government than a prescription for governing. The voters, and I think what conservatism has missed is something I see in voters when I knocked on doors and tried to convince them to vote for me. The thing I got over and over again, whether they voted for me or not, whether they were on my side or not, is they knew one thing about their lives, which is the deep interdependence of private welfare and public goods. And by public goods, I mean they know they needed schools, public transport, libraries, colleges, universities like this one, Medicare, Social Security. They knew that their standard of living, their private quality of life, depended crucially on semi-decent public provision. And I think that's a thing that we've lost sight of, that shared public goods are literally the ground under all our feet. And by that, I don't mean anything abstract. I mean schools that actually teach our kids something. You know, roads that aren't too full of potholes and get us to work. You know, hospitals that kind of try to look after us when we get sick. Social insurance that helps us have a dignified retirement. And a national defense to keep us safe. And I just do believe, maybe this is naive, but it is my belief, that progressives and conservatives could begin to align around what that agenda of basic minimum public goods provision has to be under any administration, under any government of left or right. And this will not end political debate, but it will focus it where political debate ought to be, which is how do we pay for the goods, how do we manage them, how do we make sure they're fairly developed, extended to all, and how do we ensure, and this is a conservative concern that needs to be listened to, how do we ensure that public goods don't undermine private initiative? The strong suit of conservatism in moral terms, if you're sitting where I am as a liberal progressive, the strong suit of conservatism has always been its insistence that if you have to have government at all, its function should be to enhance, not diminish, individual responsibility. And when public goods do confiscate responsibility, when they create dependency, then the incentives need to be recalibrated so citizens do shoulder the jobs that only citizens can do, which is to keep their families afloat, teach their kids good values, look after their aging parents, the things that the responsibilities that are at the core of our lives as human beings. But when we get this balance right between private initiative and public goods, then families can take on their responsibility, safe in the knowledge that they're not alone. Because if the conservative insight is that each of us is responsible for our fate, the progressive insight has always been that no one in a decent society should have to face our fate entirely alone. And that this is where there's a moment where we can begin to speak to each other. Put these together and we can maintain the public goods on which we all depend, and then work together so we shoulder the responsibilities that we must, each of us, take on our own backs. So my claim is rebuilding the common ground between progressive and conservatives depends on both sides understanding the shared public goods that are the ground under all our feet. So that's one thing I want to say to you. The other thing I want to say to you is, is there also the mystic chords of memory? We are fellow citizens. We're heirs of the same history. We're loyal to the same country. And it's foolish to politicize patriotism. Nobody has a monopoly on it. When someone questions someone's patriotism, they usually don't know what the damn word means. And voters don't like politicians who question the patriotism and civic commitment of other competitors. Playing politics is the phrase that voters use against those who drag issues of ultimate loyalty into the political arena. But I don't want to explore that so much as raise a still more difficult issue, because one of the most fundamental issues in democratic politics, and we never think about it much, is what is a political question and what shouldn't be a political question, right? And this is a hugely difficult issue to think about clearly. In many other countries outside the United States, countries which have more confidence in judges and civil servants and bureaucrats, lots of issues are actually taken out of the political arena. They're taken out of political competition. Let me give you some examples. Judicial appointments, campaign finance rules, the private lives of politicians even the delineation of electoral districts. In other democracies, you don't allow politicians to gerrymander their own electoral districts. They take that out of politics. And so one of the questions we have to think about is what should be in politics and what has to be taken out of politics for the sake of politics itself, right? That's the kind of issue I'm thinking about. Now, I don't expect America to follow the path of other nations, not just Canada, but other nations, because one of the things that outsiders like me admire about you is that you're the least elitist democracy in the world. That is, you specifically do not like it when elites get together and decide we're not going to make that a political question. You don't like that. You resent that, and you want the people to decide, and that's why everything then becomes a political question. But I think there's an issue here that Americans, we all need to think about, which is that democracies can become dysfunctional when both sides turn everything into a political question. It used to be a conservative instinct, by the way, that the less you politicize, the better. The conservative genius was that keep politics in a bounded space. Don't politicize everything. Leave a private space safe from the interference of politics. And there's a deep insight in that conservative idea. But now that conservatism in America has become so sectarian, there's nothing that's not political. When everything is political, when nothing can be safely left to reliable public servants, regulatory agencies, and the courts, when everything has to be decided politically, that usually results in deadlock. And this is a paradox about what is a political question. When everything's a political question, that invites deadlock. And deadlock is frustrating to citizens because you know that the common ground of politics is actually wider and more capacious than most politicians think. And let me make another assumption clear here. To assert that there is common ground and more common ground in politics is to take a position in the debate about why there's such polarization in the first place. And this debate is complex, and you'll hear it discussed tomorrow in the conference. And let me simplify it brutally. There's the top-down view that polarization is basically the fault of the political class. And the bottom-up view is that the polarization simply reflects the actual divisions in American society at large. Okay? Those two views, top-down, bottom-up. Now, I don't want to deny that there are deep divisions in American society, divisions of race, divisions of class, divisions of religion, divisions of region. I'm with James Madison, wonderful essay on factions in the Federalist Papers. I take it for granted, as Madison did, that voters' interests are divided and antagonistic. But whereas politicians have an interest in maximizing and exacerbating those divisions, I think voters have a competing interest, which is to ensure that the show goes on. And by show, I mean the republic. In the medium term, voters are even prepared to sacrifice getting their own interests served in the interest of making sure that the show goes on. And so I take the view that polarization is not so much a reflection from the bottom up of America's divisions as a deformation from the top down by the political class. It's a deformation of the political class's own representative function. Politicians, the worst of them, have ceased to represent citizens. They distort and exaggerate civic division, and the consequences have brought America close to standstill. I'm going to take a recent example, a controversial one. You may not agree with my read on it, but that's what we're trying to do, talk about this kind of stuff. It may be in the recent example is the confirmation battle over the next Supreme Court justice. It may be in the Senate majority leader's interest to shut down the constitutional process of advise and consent. But it's not clear to me that that's in the voters' interest. And here I would persist, just so you understand where I'm actually coming from, I'd persist in my plague on both houses analysis. The Republicans may have taken brinksmanship to a wholly new level of obstruction, but they're not wrong when they claim that this is payback time for nomination fights past, Thomas, Bork, et cetera. And this lays bare one of the deepest rules of politics and life. What goes around comes around. And I think that when the dust settles on this nomination battle after the November election, both sides, Republican and Democrat alike, may come to reflect that comity serves their interests better than confrontation. I am coming to a conclusion, folks. Bear with me, you've been very patient. I want to just make two final points. Comity is more than good manners. It is the behavioral precondition for the institutional stability of this republic. And citizens understand this instinctively. They have an enduring interest in civil peace. Politicians ought to have such an interest, but sectarian and partisan incentives lead them to brush past it. Now, when I call comity just getting along, making the system work, when I call that an interest in peace, you may think I'm being a little inflated, but I mean it seriously. Making sure our political representatives share an interest in making our institutions work is important precisely because our interests are antagonistic. Madison was right. We can't fool around here. This is a divided country. Comity is essential to keeping the show on the road. The American Civil War is never over, and the divisions of race and region that exploded into violence still haunt this republic. What the U.S. has managed just has been to move these divisions and hatreds from the realm of war to the realm of politics. And the reason I care about politics, the reason this isn't an academic subject to me, the reason I put my name on a ballot, even though I lost, is that the thing about politics, the reason we care about it, is that it is the only reliable alternative we have ever devised to war. And this should lead us, by the way, to correct certain metaphors that have crept into our language about politics. When we talk about politics as war, when we staff our campaigns with war rooms, I had a war room, when we carry the fight to the enemy, when we, quote, take no prisoners in debate, when we allow the metaphors of combat to take over our conception of politics, because language has this strange power over our imaginations, it can take us over. And we forget something simple. We forget that politics is not war by other means. It's the alternative to war. It's the alternative that allows us to fight out our disputes without burning down the house we live in together. Related to this distinction between politics and war is another distinction between the enemy and the adversary. An enemy wants to destroy you. An adversary merely wants to beat you. An enemy threatens everything you hold dear. An adversary merely wants to win. You cannot compromise with an enemy, but an adversary today may be your ally tomorrow. And so both sides, progressives and conservatives, need to understand that there is a distinction between a politics of adversaries and a politics of enemies, and we need to stay 1,000 miles away from a politics of enemies. Because the point is simple. There are no enemies. There are no enemies in the Democratic House. Yes, we face enemies. There are enemies out there. Terrorists within, hostile armies without. But within the House, anyone who lives at peace with us is an adversary, not an enemy. And democratic antagonism, necessary as it always is a debate between adversaries, never a war between enemies. And this is more, finally, than a simple plea for civility, for moderation, for niceness, for good manners. It's a call for us to understand in our bones that civil peace and the semi-adequate functioning of our institutions require us to teach and teach our children, teach ourselves, to treat our opponents as adversaries, never as enemies. And from this follows a final assumption that's kind of hopeful. An enemy can't be reasoned with, but an adversary can. We need a politics in which we hold on to the truth that we all understand in our private life. Each of us is persuadable. Each of us changes our minds. I change my mind all the time. We need a politics in which a conservative looks at a progressive and thinks, that poor soul just needs a little persuading. And a progressive thinks exactly the same thing. He'll come over. He'll see the light. He'll see the error of his ways. And that sense of persuadability lies behind this distinction between an enemy and an adversary. And if we had that sense of persuadability, if we look at each other as adversaries, never as enemies, we might understand, finally, as we often do in our private lives, that none of us has a wisdom, none of us has a monopoly on either wisdom or folly. Thanks for your attention. I am now told there is time for questions. I feel very far away from it. I wish I could, in the fashion of a TED Talk, stride up and down the platform, but I'm just too scared. So I'll stay behind my little podium here, but I do want to close the distance between us. And if I could make one little procedural suggestion. A question is a short interrogative statement followed by a question mark. Not a lot of people know that, but I thought it would be helpful to just put it out there. You know? So, and I understand there's some mics up front, and you don't look shy, so don't be shy. And the purpose of this talk was not to reduce you to stunned silence. So if anybody has a question, I'd be happy to answer.
Professor Ignatieff, thank you very much for such an enlightening talk. You're a keen observer of the American political scene. You have some distance from it because of your origins. Who on the American scene today speaks the way you do? Who is an American?
Mm-hmm. Well, Gleaves, that's a great question, and I'm not going to make you happy because it's a no names, no pactoral kind of deal here. If I name someone, that'll probably end their political career right there. You know? Oh, he's been called a moderate. End of career, you know. I don't know. Look, I think what's so puzzling about the sectarian, highly partisan character of this, I'm trying to capture the sense that so many Americans are watching this with a sense of befuddlement, a sense that there's a huge opening gap between what they actually think politics is and the way it's actually playing out on their TV screens and in debates. So that, you know, last night you have you know, two very, very serious contenders for the highest office in the country, pretty well shouting at each other. And the shouting shouting's not the worst thing in the world. My wife shouts at me, I shout at her sometime. I mean, let's not overpraise civility is what I'm saying. But, you know, the shouting concealed the fact that on certain issues, they're absolutely completely aligned. I mean, there is no difference, but they're going at each other hammer and tongs. And so who is talking about this? All kinds of people are talking about this. And if you look at, I've just been, you know, in prep for this evening, I read E.J. Dionne's book. There's a person who's talking about this. He's a liberal progressive guy, but, you know, he's from Rhode Island. You know, he's from I say this with some feeling, he's from a French-Canadian family from Rhode Island. I know where those people come from. You know, these are conservative, Catholic, God-fearing people who are the salt of the earth. And EJ has all those values, and some of those values are quite conservative. I don't know him well, so I may be misdescribing, but I kind of think that's what I'm looking at. He's a wonderful, David Brooks, another guy I read a lot in the New York Times. I don't think you can categorize David too easily. I think there's a lot of conservative things in what he says, and then sometimes there's some, you know, kind of liberal thoughts. And those kind of non-categorizable people are, I think, incredibly useful, just as I think the sessions that you've been running and the program you're running is actually very important because, you know, one of the occupational hazards of being a lecturer and a talker is we're always preaching to the converted. And it's terribly important what you're doing to create places where we don't preach to the converted, where we preach to people who don't actually agree with us and kind of then listen. And they say, that's the stupidest thing I ever heard. And then there's actually very little debate. I say this with some feeling because I come from 02138. 02138 is a zip code that is just the most liberal zip code in the United States. You never hear a discouraging word if you're a liberal. I mean, it's just paradise. Everybody agrees with you. Go into a bar, they all agree with you. You know, it's fabulous. But it's bad for you. You know, it's bad for you, is what I'm saying. And you look at these, you know, and what they call the big sort, you know, we're sorting ourselves out so we never hear a discouraging word. And that is not good for the Republic. It's not good for any country, and it's not good for this one. So, sir.
Well, I'd like to ask you two, I think, real questions and, about your relation to your dual conservative-progressive heritage that you invoked. First, much of your rhetoric, the rhetoric of comity, reminded me of kind of Richard Hofstadter and pretty much, you know, Cold War consensus-era liberals. Mm. And I would like to know if you could comment on the progressive tradition of the 1960s in relation to that. Anti-war protesters, Black power activists, activists for women rights were all accused by the people of comity of violating comity with their excessive rhetoric and activism. Do you think that that was correct? And you know, how would you judge, again, the legacy of the 1960s with respect to your ideal of comity? And the second question, at the beginning you invoked sectarians. Examples of sectarians were anti-abortion activists and anti-gay marriage activists. And I was wondering if you could comment on the historical fact that those issues of sexuality, that, as you said, you know, a conservative keeps things in a box and doesn't expand, doesn't politicize everything, that those issues, which are sectarian issues today, were brought into the public sphere, brought into politics, not by conservatives, but by progressives.
Mm-hmm. Those are very good challenges. Those are two very thoughtful points. And I will want to go away and think about them. I think the second one is right. That is that some of these very deeply and controversial and private issues were brought into the public sphere from the progressive left. But let's remember why they were brought in. I don't want to reignite all these debates, but they were brought in because women particularly on some of these issues felt very strongly that the consensus of the 40s and 50s, suffer and be still, was shutting them down. So they went into the political sphere to make claims. There were costs to making those claims because, as you say, they politicized a lot of issues that aren't sorted out really well in politics. I mean, Abortion is an absolutely explosive and passionate issue, and when you take it into politics, it's real tough to adjudicate there. But they did it for reasons that historically we need to understand, just a sense that the existing status quo was just insupportable for them. So I feel ambivalent about the politicization of intimate personal issues. But again, if you think about the cruelty and suffering that gay Americans, Americans of different gender orientations did suffer in the 50s and 60s, and I remember that. I remember a little bit what it was like. You understand why they had to take this into the public arena and why it had to be politicized. And that then gets us to the first of your questions, which is the issue of the 60s. I marched against the Vietnam War in the 60s. My hair was quite a bit longer. I hated the violence that overtook those movements by the end of the late 60s, early 70s. I felt that the guiding star of the early 60s was civil rights. If you were a Canadian, you look down to Selma, you look down to the unbelievable forbearance and moral discipline of the black leadership that fought for the right to vote. And it's their forbearance, not their comedy or their civility, but their forbearance, their refusal to allow that movement to be taken over from violence, which is an abiding lesson in both political courage, but also in political judgment. And that, as long as Martin Luther King was alive, and as long as that discipline of political forbearance dominated, I was proud to be part of the anti-war movement and, you know, a little bit part in civil rights issues. But by the 70s, it had become darker and more violent, and I don't think there's any doubt that some of the conservative counter-revolution of the 70s and 80s, I don't think you would have elected Reagan, and I don't think you would have elected Nixon without a lot of American reaction to the excesses of the 60s when it turned violent, when it turned in a curious way anti-American, because the forbearance of civil rights, I'm sorry to go on with this language, but it's churning up a lot of deep political memory for me. Part of what was so inspiring, if you were not an American, looking at those struggles of the 60s, was a forbearance that was not only that we will stay on the right, we will stay away from violence. The forbearance was also passionate love of this country. I mean, there is no more transcendent articulation of the American dream than Martin Luther King's speeches. Whether you're black, white, whatever, that was part of his political genius, was articulating what the country ought to stand for. And when the anti-war movement and when the political movement stopped articulating that positive vision of America, I think they lost the capacity to build a progressive movement of change. This is a controversial view of this, and many of you who are veterans of that era may disagree strongly with me, but that's kind of how I saw it. So I thank you for the question, and I'll go away and think about it again. And I do want to, what you were picking out about comedy, I pick up your point here. There are limits to comedy. There are moments when civil disobedience is absolutely essential in a republic. That's what Martin Luther King said. That's what some of the feminist movement believe. That's what Stonewall, the activist, said. There are moments when civil disobedience is necessary in a republic, provided it stays nonviolent. So I don't want to praise comedy to the exclusion of rising up against injustice when you have to do so. Sorry for the length of the reply. I'll try and be more focused.
Okay. Actually, I saw your talk as more about institutions and procedures than perhaps dealing with specific issues and clashing ideologies. So one of the things that I found fascinating, and I'd read you before you became a politician, was when he became a politician, I wondered what it was about Berlin or about other historical figures that you used to think about procedures and institutions bringing people with disparate views together. And I wonder if you could talk a bit more, expand a bit more about that, this the humanist and the politician. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's a funny thing. When you get into politics, you have a kind of set of illusions about how usable all that wonderful education of yours is and all those wonderful books are. And what you end up doing trying to keep a caucus together, you know, you're kind of, talk about herding cats, it's caucus management. And I'd be very frank with you, I gave, you know, highfalutin speeches that used my humanist training when I began in politics, and I quickly understood something that I think is a painful lesson for a professor in politics, which is that I needed to learn to reach ordinary folks, and I had to understand that big words in a fancy education codes as privilege, and they shut you down very quickly. I would love to have quoted Isaiah Berlin at length, in extenso, in my speeches across Canada, in Tim Hortons restaurants and all the places I was, but I quickly learned it wasn't exactly working. I don't for a second mean to be anti-intellectual about politics. I would say honestly that political life was the most intellectually and morally demanding thing I ever did in my life. And I have enormous respect, despite critical things I've said about politics. I have enormous respect, the respect that only a loser can have for those who do it successfully and well and do it half decently. But it, you can speak in poetry, but you govern in prose, and your job is very, very practical, and it's a problem. Your horizons foreshorten, and there were a lot of times when I thought, if I could get to tomorrow morning, I would feel fabulous. You know, so you don't think the big thoughts, and that's a confession. I wish I'd been able to think bigger thoughts, but there we are. Sorry to be so disappointing. Thank you for the question. Sir.
Professor Ignatieff, again, welcome. We're glad to have you. And if you get tired of your colleagues in 02138, we could probably find a way to put you to work here at Grand Valley State.
Thank you, Dean. Thank you very much.
There are billions of dollars being spent on this election, not just at the presidential level or the national level, but all the way down to library millages. Mm-hmm. I wonder if you could talk about the role of politics and the role of money in politics, and to the extent that it's corrosive, whether there's a way back.
Yeah. That's a great question. And here I do feel my Canadian-ness showing up. Most liberal democracies, or most democracies in the world, understand that in politics, money is power. And most democracies, and I'm not going to give you a lecture in comparative government, but most democracies limit the power of money in politics because it's power, and because they want to safeguard the equality of the vote. The democratic principle is that, you know, each of us counts for one and nobody counts for more than one. And this is the only democracy that has entrenched in constitutional law the doctrine that money is speech. And it's real tough to fix that. And I think it's a problem. I won't relitigate all of that because that's an issue that I think you have to sort out. But I would think there must be some form of common ground between a conservative who believes in democracy and wants every vote to count, and a liberal have the same thing. But you're very divided on that. More conservatives believe that money is speech than believe that money is power, and more liberals believe that money is power than believe that it's money is speech. And that's just where we are, it seems to me. But the interesting thing about the money issue is it shows, at least to me, how dynamic the technologies are and how badly pundits and experts are understanding what's happening. I seem to remember a 2014 discussion about Sheldon Adelson, the Koch brothers, the nefarious George Soros on the other side, the nefarious influence of big money. So that's what we were worried about, that half a dozen billionaires would decide who is the next nominee. Well, we don't seem to be in that situation in 2016. What we did not anticipate is a self-funding billionaire on one side, and we didn't anticipate, this is in some sense the most amazing thing at all, we did not anticipate that a very hard-working senator from a small state in his 70s would out-fundraise the greatest fundraisers in Democratic politics in 40 years, the Clintons. It's astounding. Whatever you think of his politics, Bernie Sanders has been able to do in terms of leveraging money. So this election is not being dominated by the plutocrats. It's actually the drivers of it are internet-based fundraising for Sanders on the one hand and self-financing by a billionaire on the other. So every time we think we've understood what the problem of money in politics is, it shifts. And I'm very encouraged, whatever you think about Mr. Sanders, and I have no brief for his policies, I'm not going there, but it is impressive how effectively he has used the new technologies to raise money, and he's built on the success that began with Howard Dean and then with Mr. Obama and on and on. And that then does change the game. I mean, Mr. Sanders is raising money 25 bucks a time. That sounds pretty good to me. And it gets you around the money is power thing, because if you aggregate sufficient amount of $25 donations, you got as much power as anybody else. And that, so that's what I think about money and power. I mean, if you want to know what a Canadian thinks, he thinks, let me be perfectly candid, you guys are nuts. I mean, in Canada, the campaign finance limits were so strict that every single dollar I ever received in my entire political life, together with the name, address, and phone number of the person who gave it to me, is on a government website. So everybody just goes and looks up and finds out the entirety of my backers, not just the big money guys, because they were limited to $1,200, but the little guys as well, everybody. It's a big, long list. And if you ask me, that's the way you do it. But that's big government, you know, that's something else. So I don't think it's going to happen here. But I'll tell you, the good thing about that is it freed me. That's what you don't understand about campaign finance. From a political point of view, it freed me. I couldn't take anything in a paper bag. I couldn't take anything that wasn't receipted. It had to go up to Ottawa. Some bureaucrat went through it. And I can look you in the eye and say, every dollar that ever financed my political activity is on a website. So if you accuse me of corruption, you can all go to hell. You know that? Do you know what I mean? That's what I mean. It frees you up. And it helps the political system. And I don't know why politicians here don't grab on that, because it frees them up of often unjust accusation. So there we are. Sorry, question.
Professor Ignatieff, thank you for coming here. I have a question about culture. So you mentioned Trump voters and you mentioned Bernie Sanders mm-hmm. voters, and in many ways these are voters anew. They're coming, they're birthing new voters, they're bringing in, mm-hmm. in new voters, whether they're old or young. I mean, we obviously see with Sanders that these are many young people for the first time, and then with With Trump, we see people who have felt disenfranchised for very many different reasons coming back in. So people aren't born cosmopolitan. They're born rather sectarian, and they come to value you know, their own needs, their family needs, those around them. And these are new voters for whatever reason. And so how do we move from sectarian? Because that they're cutting their teeth, many of them, for the first time on this election. And they're impassioned by those sectarian beliefs. And so how do we move them to, how do they move from being sectarian? And a disclaimer, what's wrong with sectarianism? And should we be cosmopolitan? Why be cosmopolitan? To kind of move it into the more philosophical, but just at the kind of popular culture level, to say, go from sectarian to cosmopolitan, what would give you the taste? What would make you desire that? And so I'm kind of looking for from the philosophical to the popular culture, what would move voters to want to move toward that common ground, to become that kind of voter?
I talked about the authority that goes with failure, but since I was so unsuccessful in politics, you shouldn't trust any of my answers on that question, because I didn't do such a terrific job I would quarrel a little bit with the distinction between sectarian and cosmopolitan. I didn't use the word cosmopolitan. I'm a little anxious about it, and I'll tell you, having been a political actor, there is no quicker way to die politically than to portray yourself as a cosmopolitan. And that's important. I mean, what you're saying is people are rooted. People are deeply committed to where they come from and where they're raised. And I was very, you know, touched talking to some of you before this talk tonight, that at least three of you said, you know, we lived in other places, we lived in Europe, we lived in Cleveland, we lived here and there, and we came back here. Why did you come back here? Because you like it here, and you care about it, and it matters to you. And you want, if you have political representatives, you want to have someone who knows why the heck Grand Rapids matters to you, and why Michigan matters to you, and where this part of the world matters to you. And I do think that that visceral attachment to place and location and history is crucial to political appeal, and politicians who connect to that and understand it and respect it and feel it in their bones are going to be more successful than people who are more rootless and give them lectures talking down to them from Harvard and all the other places I've been. So that would be the start. You mentioned the Sanders and Trump electorate. And to cut to the chase on that, I think you're absolutely right that both of these candidates are bringing new people into the political system. That was something I thought what you said was absolutely right. I think my worry about it is I just don't want them to be peddled false solutions. That's the problem. It's terrific that candidates are picking up the anger out there. But don't exploit the anger with garbage. That's what I'm saying back. I mean, there is. I'm not going to unpack the platforms, okay? Because that would be foolish. But I have a bad feeling about whether either of these, the two gentlemen who brought a lot of that, who found that anger and sought it out and brought these folks to the rallies and got them fired up. I just worry that these very good, hardworking Americans are being fed snake oil on both sides. And that's the problem. Their anger is being cultivated. You know, it's good to be angry, good to be furious. You've been screwed. Life is unfair. You know, free trade doesn't work for you. Your incomes are stagnating. Here's my solution. It's at the solution. I mean, it's at the solution level that I start to get angry. And because I just do think that the test of politics is not that you have a solution to everybody's problem, but that you really are actually addressing what the problem is and trying conscientiously to, you know, to make it better for them. And politics is so disillusioning to people because politicians are so much better at stroking the anger and resentment of electorates than they are in actually fixing what's wrong, you know. And that's, I see, is about to happen again on both sides of the political divide. That would be my concern about that.
Of the challenge in finding common ground is the slippery slope problem, that psychology that if you yield a little bit, then all of a sudden all is lost. I think that happens a lot in the abortion arena. And I wonder if you have thoughts on what might make us more comfortable or how we could overcome that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's well said. I think it's a real problem. I've noticed whenever I compromised in politics, people would say, he's gone mushy, you know. What does he actually stand for? That kind of compromise moderation can get you under the slippery slope in which you appear not to have convictions that can't be moved and can't be budged. And that's a real issue. That's just a standard dilemma, both in our personal lives and in our public lives. And I think it is, your example is well taken. People, there is a ground in the middle on that issue, but getting there is incredibly hard on both sides for important reasons that have to do with ultimate moral conviction. So anybody who goes into that middle ground ends up being despised by both sides very frequently. But that is often sometimes the test of political courage as well. I mean, I just, I said a couple of times in the talk, I just think that the ultimate job of a politician is not often to change the world. His actual job, or her actual job, is to keep the show on the road in the sense of preserving the republic, or in my case, preserving our little constitutional monarchy, but just preserving it, keeping it going. Because the thing that you learn when you're in politics and you get out of the ivory tower is that we are very divided. We don't agree on that issue, on many other issues. And the job of a politician is create some kind of space where we, sometimes what a politician is trying to get you to is let's agree to disagree. It's a great piece of human wisdom to agree to disagree. Many marriages survive on that premise alone, mine included. You know, agree to disagree. Because what you value is the unit, the republic, more than you value your own righteousness. And that's just, you know, a value I hold, but it's not a value that deals very well with people who value their convictions more than they value holding the show together. But I'm aware that my views are not everybody else's views. I mean, I'm taking a controversial. Sir.
Professor, you are from a country with three political parties. In this country, our two political parties used to have moderate and progressive and conservative wings to them, but the two parties have moved, one to the American equivalent of left, which most people would find pretty conservative, the other one to a increasingly strident right. You have three parties. Your party is basically the center party. Mm-hmm. The New Democratic Party is to the left, and do they still call themselves the Progressive Conservatives?
No, they call themselves the Conservatives significantly. Okay. They got rid of that fuzzy thing there.
That P part. Yeah. Okay. So I'd like you to just comment on whether you think that with the, and I think there are a number of people in this room, I know a number of people in this room, that are no longer comfortable in what have been their political parties. Yeah. I'm one. Yeah. And yet I'm not comfortable with the other party. What is your thought about having three political parties? And secondly, were you defeated by an NDP or a conservative?
I have the unique distinction of having been beaten by both.
Well, okay.
As I said, I bled left and bled right. That's a pretty neat trick, you know. That sometimes happens when you're in the middle, but that's fine. That was the voters' judgment, and as you know, the voters are always right. Your question is an excellent one, and we know from the statistics that, what is it, 20, 30, 35? I always tell my students, never trust me when I use a number, and this would be the case here. 30% of the American electorate is independent. I mean, there are a lot of people like you, sir, who just, I don't know whether you are an independent, but you're not firmly aligned with either of the political parties on offer. Uh-huh.
I now consider myself to be an independent. Republican.
Right. Okay. And I having led a centrist party, and having which, I mean, the thing about Canada is that it's one of the largest democracies by size in the world, with intense regional divisions. Et on parle deux langues aussi. On parle français aussi. J'ai dû parler français la moitié du temps. Okay. So you can imagine the challenges of maintaining the political unity of a political formation that goes from Vancouver on the one end to St. John's, Newfoundland on the other, up to the Arctic Circle and down to a couple miles from you guys.
Right.
And it led me to believe passionately, to get to an answer to your question, in the value of coalition building. I mean, I just think that's the noblest function of a party, which is to put a lot of people in the room who don't like each other very much, who come from very radically different places, don't even speak the same darn language, and get them to agree on a couple of things we can do together. Because if you don't have that, you don't have a country, is what I felt. To a degree that I think people don't realize, coalition formations within these parties is absolutely crucial to the national unity of countries. And that's what the vocation of my party historically has been. It was to put the French Canadians and the English Canadians in one room and find something we could agree enough so we didn't pull the place apart. And also get the Aboriginals in there, because we got a very substantial Aboriginal issue, and you know, we try and broker this stuff. Now, the problem with sectarianism is that sectarians don't want to do coalition building, because that's not what they think politics is about. Politics is about the vindication of certain principles, getting back to certain bedrock truths. And an extreme sectarian actually has the view that's not necessarily particularly democratic, which is, my view is correct if only five people in the world believe it, right? And I think that that's just a different view of politics. That the thing I learned about being a party leader is that I just didn't know a lot of stuff. There was stuff I needed to learn. I needed to understand that if I said something about, let's go to a hot topic, if I said something about gun control that worked really terrifically in downtown Toronto, it just lost me every seat in the north of my country. It lost all of them, right? I had to understand that the business of maintaining the national unity, first of my party, but of the country, was finding a way to bridge almost impassable gaps between northern hunters and downtown condo dwellers who don't want handguns around. And I think that's what politics is, finding some way in which we can remain in the same room. But the respect for the nobility of coalition formation is declining, because the sectarian view is that it doesn't matter if only five people believe me because I'm right, is just antithetical to the politics I think you need to maintain a two-party system. And you will have three parties or four parties, possibly, if the view of politics prevails that politics is about making sure your side or your segment or your region or your issue wins to the exclusion of others. And I just think that, so I have a pretty strong attachment to coalition formation as the essence of national parties. We had three parties, and we had four parties in our country. Not just three, but four, because we have a French-speaking party that wants to take us out of the country. That's an amazing thing about Canada, by the way, just by the by, which is that I sat in a parliament with French-speaking guys who would never speak to me in English, because it's a matter of principle to speak their language, who get up in a parliament every day of their lives, and their stated object is to take the country apart. And this is the paradox. They were fabulous colleagues, good friends, great parliamentarians, wonderful respect for the institution they wanted to destroy. Go figure. That's democracy to me. That's what I loved about it, right? But I think you'll be ill-served if somebody sets up a third party in this country. I mean, we've run the experiments on that. It doesn't tend to work. But we may be looking, if this Republican convention happens in Cleveland and there's enough blood on the walls, who knows? It is conceivable that that party will fracture. But my sense is, you know, that might be good for the Democrats, but it's not good for the country. That would be my instinct. You know, there are Democrats out there thinking, it's fabulous, the Republicans are self-destructing. Wait a minute, folks. A strong party system with good alternation, good competitive relation between two broad coalitions is what holds this country together. Well, I know. That's why common ground efforts like this are so important. Sir.
Professor Ignatieff, I really appreciate your comments. And this question is about the quality of politicians. And I wouldn't say it applies to Canada, certainly, but there was a congressman from Iowa, Jim Leach, moderate Republican, who served, elected in 76, defeated in 2006. Voted against Clinton impeachment and pardon, well-regarded intellectual in politics. And when he was defeated in 2006, he was asked, what is the biggest change you saw in politics across those 30 years? And he said it was the decline of the quality of the politicians. Yeah. And again, that does not apply to our neighbor of the north, most obviously, but I was struck by that he would say that. For 30 years, he saw the quality. I wonder if you think he was correct, and is that part of our problem today?
I think it is a problem. I think there's no question. A 24-hour news cycle feels that when you're a politician, you're constantly inside a washing machine being washed. I mean, just tumbling over and over. I mean, it's incredibly stressful. The proliferation of the cell phone and the cell phone camera means there's simply no off-the-record private meeting ever. The minute you walk into a room, you can be photographed or can be, so there's no off, you're always on. The beast of 24-hour news has to be fed literally every 20 minutes. It's very hard to deliberate, it's very hard to think in that environment. The toll that it exacts on a private life is huge. If you love your wife or your husband, it's really tough. If you love your kids, it's really tough. All that stuff is true. It seems a little fatuous to ask voters to feel sorry for politicians, but it is having an effect. A lot of smart people, I mean, I notice at the Kennedy School and at Harvard, I teach a lot of wonderful, bright Americans and people from all over the world. I would think 3% of them want to go into politics. Most of them want to go to Silicon Valley or go down to Wall Street or, you know, start an NGO. And the interesting thing is that they do not lack for conscience. They do not lack for civic commitment. They just think politics is the worst way to display conscience and civic commitment. They want to do, you know, they set their own, do it a different way. So I think there is a problem there. But we still are getting some pretty amazing people stepping up, crazy people who haven't been told how tough it is. They still come forward. But I think there is some concern about that. I think these things also go in cycles. Why did I go into Canadian politics? It sounds ridiculous, because of Jack Kennedy and Bobby Kennedy and you know, and wonderful, inspiring people like that, you know, and Martin Luther King and people, you know, I mean, you never underestimate the enormous influence of good example thousands of miles away, you know, and Václav Havel and Mandela, all these, you know, for the next generation, Mandela, I hope, will inspire a generation of African leaders to step up. We haven't seen it yet, but I sure hope so. Example is crucial here, and that's the thing that'll make a difference.
Last question. Thank you. I was wondering if you could speak to two other things that I think contribute, if not to polarization, then certainly to undermining the robustness of our civic culture and our the enfranchisement of our voters. One would be the role of the media, mm-hmm. right? So what role does that play in contributing to this creation of sectarianism and polarization? And the second is about laws that affect voters. So gerrymandering of districts, voter ID laws. So these other things that get in the way of common ground.
Yes, excellent questions. I don't have anything very smart to say about the media, except that one of the illusions you have when you go into politics is that you think that the media are the umpires, the referees of the contest. And I remember kind of, you know, you get a cheap shot and you go to a journalist and you say, why didn't you do something about that? I mean, you know, I mean, come on, it was below the belt, you know, come on, write the story. And the journalist said to me, I don't think you understand my job. My job is to sit on top of the hill and watch the battle and then come down and shoot the wounded. I thought that was wonderful, folks. He became a very good friend, you know, because there was some deep truth to that. You know, these guys are not here to help you. They're not here to referee the battle. They're here to shoot the wounded and, you know, to stimulate conflict, and that's where you're absolutely right. There's no question that the 24-hour cycle is just creating this kind of barking circus on 24-hour platforms, and it's not good. But the optimistic thing I would say about the press is that a couple of things. First of all the platforms are burning. The economic viability of all the old journalistic models is kind of collapsing. We're in the middle of the Gutenberg revolution in the media, and it's actually very exciting. And from a certain point of view, from a media consumer's point of view, the amount of information that I have at my fingertips to make informed electoral choices has never been greater. I mean, it's fragmented. You got to look. You got to go to these sites and that sites. But compared to the kind of mass media diet of the 60s and 70s, the kind of Desi and Lucille era of our lives, I think, in fact, this is a golden age in an odd way for consumers to figure out voters to figure out who's telling the truth. So I actually think that side of it is pretty good. And I think there's so many insurgent platforms now that you really have, in fact, more pluralism of political opinion than you've had in the past. Question. So that's one thing. And you asked a second question, and because I am an aging gentleman, my declining years, I forgot what it was. Oh, voter IDs. Oh, yes. Yeah, absolutely. Hey, here's another place where, in passing, I said one of the questions in politics is what should be a political question. And one of the most difficult issues for all political systems is to take the rules out of the hands of politicians, to find some way, for example, on electoral redistricting, to just make gerrymandering impossible because you give it to nonpartisan, you know, judicial commissions. Now, in Canada, I mean, I know this is going to get nauseating because you're going to start thinking, he thinks his country is perfect. I don't think my country is perfect, but it was unthinkable for me to even think of gerrymandering my own electoral district. It wasn't in my hands. There's a commission that does it and does it on the basis of population, and you don't mess around. I mean, you just don't. It doesn't make our system wonderful, but it's just one trick I couldn't play. I mean, there's some sense in which a healthy political system is a system in which politicians' hands on certain questions are tied, like who gets to vote and what the electoral district is. Now, when I say this in my classroom to my American students, they kind of roll their eyes at my deep, incorrigible naivete. I mean, how could I ever believe that there could be such a thing as an impartial redistricting commission? How could I ever believe that there could be state election laws that weren't tampered with all the time? How could we just get some procedural agreement about what the rules are, which is that if you're 18 and do not have a felony conviction, you get to vote, and it should be really easy to vote, et cetera. I mean, could we just agree about that, and then we can have electoral competition? But, you know, my knowing American friends say, boy, you Canadians, you just don't get it. But I would say to you that almost every democratic system understands a crucial thing about politics, which is that it's very important to take the rules out of the hands of the players, okay? And other countries do that, and they have better democracies as a result. So I want to thank you for your attention. It's been great dialoguing with you.